and this here may be tough to you. Snack cake to me, yeah, more hosts.
All hosts.
This been overdue forever. Asked me when it was dropping, said never.
Never.
Should've made you cut the feather, but I designed it Freemason Margiela.
What's goody, Shell? Trying here the most woke, no joking. I'm back at it again with a brand new video and won't bluff. Look, man, like I said in an earlier video, look, content is kind of slow right now. So, this is actually a video that was requested by two different people, but there are two different topics that are basically very intertwined, so I'm putting them into one video. Either way, the two questions I was asked in two separate videos was, what do you think about the Panthers bringing back Trey Boston, and what do you think about the Panthers picking up Earl Thomas, or potentially trading for Earl Thomas? And I'll get to both those in a second. But before I get into those players specifically, let me tell you a little bit about our situation right now, where we stand. Right now, we have about $3 million in cap space. What does that mean? That means we have not much to work with, so we can't really pick up a really good player unless we extremely backload their contract, which no one wants to do, really, because, I mean, there's no guaranteed contracts in the NFL, and yeah, a lot of things can happen. More importantly, if with our $3 million in cap space, we are kind of, our feet are held to the fire a little bit, because what if someone gets injured during training camp or minicamp? What if someone gets injured during the preseason? What do we do then? What money, if we pick up someone now and use up all of our cap space, what players can we pick up to add to our 53-man roster later on down the road? So I think about that. We're thinking about, did we use our draft picks in our other offseason moves for nothing? Why don't we see how Denoris Searcy works out and how Rashawn Golden works out? We don't even know what we really have yet. I think our coaching staff would really want to see what we have first before plunging and spending money and not even being certain if what we have to work with is already adequate. Now, I'll go with what we can talk about the quickest here first, and that's Trey Boston. Look, a lot of y'all like Trey Boston because we drafted him and he played 3 years in Carolina, but I don't know if you guys, maybe it's some revisionist history because he had one good year for the Chargers, but if y'all remember, Trey Boston wasn't all that great for us in Carolina. Now, he wasn't bad, but he wasn't by any stretch of the imagination impressive. His rookie season in 2014, I mean, he had one interception for a touchdown, four passes defended, and 22 tackles. And then in 2016, he had 38 tackles, two sacks, seven passes defended, and two interceptions. Those are decent numbers. When you think about it, like, okay, well, I mean, maybe isn't he good, though? I mean, look, no matter what those stats look like, with the Chargers last year, he had 56 tackles. He had, five interceptions and eight passes defended. So he's good now, right? You have to remember, Trey Boston was in a contract year, so he had to play his heart out. He's in a different scheme. And what you don't want to do when you're talking about football players, but really people in general, is you don't let them show you who they are for 3 years or for a long time. And then once you get rid of them, once they're out of your life, they show you something really different for a fraction of the time that you were with them, and you want to go running back to them. That's a metaphor. Think about it a little bit more about that, because that might save you a lot of time, a lot of heartache. Anyway, that's all this video is about, man. Just think about that. You don't want to let someone show you who they are, and then for a fraction of the time, once they're out of your life, they show you a little bit of improvement, and you go running back to them because you don't know what you have on the other side already in your possession. Anyway, Trey Boston, for me, he was decent, but the biggest thing for me is that he went for the big hit every single time, and he would miss on tackles. I don't have a stat. That's an advanced analytic, missed tackles, but this man would literally go for big hits way too often and would whiff on tackles, and that is not what you want in our defense. There's not much more I can say about Trey Boston. He's cheap. I think our last year of a contract with him was we paid him $100,000 in 2017, and he only signed to the Chargers for $900K with a $100K signing bonus, so basically $1 million. And we could pick him up, but then again, why pay for him right now when the safety market is trash? The player's value is only going down, which sucks for the players, but works out pretty well for the teams. This gets a little bit more in-depth and a little bit more complicated here because there's a few things working for and against Earl Thomas here for us and for him. First off, Earl Thomas is expensive. I have to look at his contract right here, man. So his last contract was a 4-year, $40 million, and he's due to make, I think he's due to make 10.4, but really 8.5 because his signing bonus was 1.9 for this season. So a salary, a base salary of 8.5 million, which we can't do. But either way, this is the last year of his contract. So if we were to trade the Seahawks for Earl Thomas, why don't we trade for a rental of a 30-year-old safety, where safeties aren't even coming off the market right now? And his next contract that comes up in 2019 will probably be his last. So he's trying to make his money at the maximum dollars he can. And even though we do have some cap space coming up in this next year, we probably shouldn't pull that trigger now and get rid of pieces or even picks. I mean, Earl Thomas is gonna, off of name alone, he's gonna like demand a second or a third round pick out of whoever picks him up. I don't think he's worth a first round pick, although the Seahawks might try to shop him for that at first, but probably a second or third round pick for Earl Thomas. And I mean, his stats kind of back it up. I mean, he's not, you know who Earl Thomas, I don't have to say anything about, I don't have to give any like preamble. Let's go from the last 3 years. I mean, 42, 24, and 56 tackles, 5-2-2 interceptions. A pick for a touchdown last year. The thing about Earl Thomas is he may not give you big, big, huge numbers, but he's a big hitter and people don't want to throw his way. So even though these numbers don't exactly pop up at you here, Earl Thomas is still a very viable and a very effective safety in the league. But you already knew that. What you probably don't know, though, is that Earl Thomas would probably not even work out in our system. You guys know we run zone. We run a cover two, but it's really a Tampa 2 scheme where it's a cover three out of a cover two shell. What that means is that we show cover two at the snap, and we have our two safeties are playing high in sidelines, and our middle linebacker, obviously Luke, is going. He's showing up at the in the box, but for the most part, he's dropping back as the middle third safety in the field. The biggest weakness in a cover two scheme is the seams. So if there's a good route running pass catching running back or a good route running catching tight end in the league, you run up the seams and the cover two is basically beat. But when we run a Tampa two, we had that roaming linebacker, the best coverage linebacker in the game, and Luke Kuechly watching that middle and going back deeper into the zone. We cover up that weakness once the ball is snapped. So we run a pretty good scheme that really works out well for us. But the big thing about the Seahawks and Earl Thomas specifically is that the Seahawks are on a cover three defense. And it would be a little bit different if Earl Thomas was a corner or even maybe a strong safety. And in a cover three defense, in that kind of scheme, the free safety plays the middle of the field. He's already, before the ball snapped, it's not like a shell where they go into a different coverage. When the ball is snapped, he starts off in the middle of the field. Our scheme, we don't have a safety in the middle of the field. We use our linebacker there. And when we do bring another DB on the field, it's usually for a nickel, and that's not what we're going to have Earl Thomas doing. So the cover three, the two cornerbacks go deep, and then we just have the free safety in the middle of the field up top, and the strong safety plays down. They usually walk the strong safety down to be in the box most of the time, but sometimes he just stays back there a little bit, like a little, maybe 3 to 5 yards deeper than the linebackers, and then he comes down or just sits there. But for the most part, it's where the two safeties are in the cover two is where the corners are in the cover three, and the middle of the field, where Luke Kuechly would usually be, is where their free safety is. And so we're not gonna get rid of what Luke does best, which is coverage. He also a ball hog. He can stop the run, be in coverage, but he's the best at coverage as a linebacker. And we're not gonna negate that by putting Earl Thomas, an expensive safety, to do what Luke is the best at as a linebacker. And it doesn't make sense for our scheme. Now, is Steve Wilks smart enough to switch up our scheme a little bit? Yes, but that also changes the roles and the responsibilities of our corners, which you already know we have some questions about what our corners can actually do. What's their skill set? Are we actually 100% confident that they can play deep? Do we want our corners playing really deep and being our last line of defense back there? I don't know. Do we want our safety in the box, really, when we need help over top, when we already have really good linebackers? I don't know. The answer to that one is no. The answer to that is definitely no. So I'm thinking that Earl Thomas is a good, it's a good name. You always want to have a big name player on your team. But when you think about how much he costs, that we don't really know what we have yet, and that the scheme he runs doesn't really work well for the scheme that we run a lot, it's probably not a good idea to pull the trigger on that and give him the contract he wants for the next 3 to 4 years and basically restructure our whole defense around Earl Thomas. Because you don't pick up and pay Earl Thomas to put him in a system that he can't run or he doesn't run or hasn't run for no real reason. And I think Steve Wilks is smart enough and is good enough at his job that we can work with what we have right now, find out what we have in Rashawn Golden, find out what we have in Denoris Searcy, make sure our corners are playing the flats in the Tampa 2, don't have whoever we have going back there, Bradbury, Action Jackson, whoever we have as our corners, I don't think we want them pushing all the way back and being the corner three deep men back there. I think we're straight with this having two high safeties and Luke roaming in the middle. But what do y'all think, man? Am I way off base? Do you think we should still pick up Earl Thomas or Trey Boston? Let me know in the comments below, man. And you already know to do with that like button.
Cheers to you, appreciate the chance. Being told y'all I've been the man. Being told y'all I had the gift. Tell a friend to tell a friend. Real ones gonna recommend. Count this as another win.